This video was sponsored by CuriosityStream.
Have you ever looked away from a franchise you loved as a kid and come back as an adult to discover that it just kept going without you? The Swan Princess was supposed to be a relic of my childhood, and my childhood alone. It was a game I remembered playing with my sisters at the pool. It was a little nugget to sit in the back of my brain when I was older and cultured and saw Swan Lake. It was three movies that I liked as a kid, and there was no reason why it needed to be anything more than that. I was wrong, as I found out something like 6 years ago when I went to see what they had at the local Redbox, and there was the Swan Princess. With a kid! With an eye patch! I have like six questions! And of course, at the time, that was just a silly little anecdote. Hey, there are more Swan Princess movies now, and they're bending genre and stuff, and I didn't give it another thought. My life was a simple one. A peaceful one. A happy one. But I live on the internet now, and I need content, so naturally, I watched all 10 Swan Princess movies. That's right! There are 10 of these! 10! I have been on an odyssey, and I don't know if I'll ever recover.
Let's do this.
Part 1, The Swan Princess.
I already did that shit. Statistically, you already watched it. This is a transparent ploy to get you to come back to my channel, because if you ask me, I'm making much better shit now. Go watch it again if you want, I don't care. Just please, for the love of all that is holy, come back when you're done. Come back to me. Please. 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 Baby. Baby, please, please, baby, please, come back!
Part 2, The Swan Princess and the Secret of the Castle.
Okay, right off the bat, we're in the Berenstain universe. That's not really the title, is it?
No.
Well, sort of. The original release of this movie was called The Swan Princess Escape from Castle Mountain, and The Secret of the Castle was the title of the European release. Philosopher's Stone in reverse. Whatever. But I guess they changed their minds again, because this triple feature thing I bought calls it The Secret of the Castle, and it's obviously not a European release because I could watch it on my Region 1 Blu-ray player. What happened? Escape from Castle Mountain is such a better title. Much better clickbait. But apparently, Secret of the Castle is the title of the movie now, so I guess that's what we're going with. This one, okay, so the first three of these movies were staples of my childhood, and even back then, this was clearly the worst one. It was only worth getting out of the library if the other two were already checked out, or if we'd just returned the other two, so I wasn't really expecting much, and I got pretty much what I expected. So this movie is not very good. It did get a theatrical release, which is surprising based on how distinct all of the hallmarks of a direct-to-home video sequel are.
The only returning members of the voice cast are Michelle Nicastro as Odette, Steve Vinovich as Puffin, and James Arrington as Chamberlain. Nobody has a separate singing voice anymore, and I mean, no hate to Nicastro, but Liz Calloway is quite an act to follow.
All the wonder and surprise of knowing that the is yet to come.
There's also a lot of animation that is just transparently recycled from the original, so there's your drinking game. But most importantly, this movie establishes a number of patterns which will pervade the rest of the series. Number one, the movie opens on a character we have never met doing something of unclear significance.
Who is this dude? What is he doing? Why should we care? I don't know, and I'm not going to for another 10 minutes.
Is this an effective hook masterfully creating a knowledge gap to pique the viewer's curiosity?
Number two, Derek and Odette's marriage is a mess and they never resolve their issues. Shocker.
In this one, Derek works too hard and is constitutionally incapable of delegating, and Odette is stuck in the castle twiddling her thumbs and wondering when her husband will return from the war.
Number three, Derek does nothing and everyone's obsessed with him.
It does not matter what heroic acts anyone else in these movies commits, the villains always just laser fucking focus on this guy.
Sure.
So here we've got Clavius, not Claudius, Clavius.
Sure.
Who was an associate of Rothbart's in developing the Forbidden Arts, but Rothbart kicked him to the curb, and so now he wants to kill Derek because
Derek killed Rothbart, and so if Clavius can kill Derek, then that'll prove that Clavius is a stronger and better sorcerer than Rothbart. So Clavius kidnaps Huberta to get Derek out of the castle so he can sneak in and steal the Forbidden Arts and then kill Derek. Yeah, the Forbidden Arts is a physical thing now that can be stolen or destroyed. Sure. You may notice that it seems like this leaves essentially nothing for our title character to do. And you would be correct. She does have, like, one pretty solid moment early on when Derek has bailed on her because there's a fire burning in the distance, and Odette, she's a helper, so she hops in a wagon full of jugs of water and blankets to go take care of the villagers. And Derek's like, it's not safe. And she's like, fuck you, you can't skip out on our anniversary dinner and tell me what to do. I like it. Less so what follows.
I can see why I married you. You're so good at saying you're wrong.
The Straits are not okay. But then the plot happens and Clavius locks her in a tower and she's stuck there until... Number four, Odette needs to be a swan again. This is a really fun one because as soon as you see it in this movie, knowing that there are 10 of these bad boys, you can see exactly where it's going. Fucking fabulous, if you ask me. So in this one, she's locked in a tower, and she knows Derek is headed into a trap, and the quickest and most effective way she can get to him is if she gets Bridget to use the skills she picked up from Rothbart to turn her into a swan so she can escape out the window and fly to her love, knowing that if she fails in her quest to take down Clavius, she may never be human again. Woo! Unfortunately, a swan is also a pretty easy threat for a human adversary to incapacitate, so she gets one decent day-saving moment, but mostly this climactic battle is all about Derek and Clavius, and Odette's on civilian rescue duty. Which, to be clear, that's a choice made by the framing to focus less on our title character and all of her friends banding together to save someone we know and remember from the first movie, and more on her deadbeat boyfriend buckling some swash with a guy who makes traps? Don't worry though, it all works out in the end, and I lied to you! Derek does demonstrate half a modicum of growth.
You take care of it, Rogers.
A gentleman caller, hooray! I don't know why I wrote that line, it just feels right there, you know? Number five, the music sucks. This one at least consistently remembers whether or not it is a musical, which is, spoiler, about as much as we can hope for going forward with this franchise, but like, do I just have my nostalgia goggles on for the first movie and the first movie only? Like, it's no Alan Menken, obviously, but the music is solid. What happened? I don't get it.
Tell me the magic words to say to bring back the magic of love.
This is still Lex de Azevedo.
You hang on through the hard times.
Make them laugh when they're feeling low.
Like, they swapped out his co-lyricist, but Lex... Buddy, what happened?
But believe me, it's true. There are things you can do to pull you through so you can say
no fear.
Gotta say it again.
Oh my god! Clavius' song is good though.
You gotta love this power of mine. Oh yeah!
I wanna say something nice about this movie though, which is that Huberta is a literal queen and a literal queen. Christy Landers understood the assignment.
Well, I've got a number for you, buddy! 86!
She picked up that football and she ran with it.
When Derek finds out about this, you will be in significant trouble!
She eats in this movie. It's a delight.
I may be a hostage, but I am still the queen! And it is still my birthday!
This kind of ends up being Huberta's movie more than anyone else's, and... I think we stan? Yeah. Yeah, we stan. Part 3, The Mystery of the Enchanted Treasure. This movie is just straight up, like, the team realized that they beefed it on the last one, and they wanted another shot at it, and this time they actually nailed it. Like, everything about this series is better if you just pretend that this movie takes place right after the first one, and the second one never happened. Derek and Odette are throwing a festival because the threat hanging over the head of their kingdom is finally over. Perfect, yes, just pretend that they're talking about Rothbart. Clavius meant nothing, baby. I only have eyes for you. Our baddie is once again a jilted former associate of Rothbart's with a bumbling sidekick who we meet in a weird cold open before we have any idea who they are or why we should care, and once again she wants to retrieve the forbidden arts from the castle. But she doesn't care about Derek. She's just, you know, evil. And like, honestly, she fucks.
Now we will rule as king and queen. yeah, they were definitely fucking. There's like one mention of Clavius specifically, but just like, block that out. It's like he never existed. All is forgiven, my love. This is the Swan Princess too now. Even Huberta is better in this one. She's still a literal queen and a literal queen, and this time she's got interesting stuff to do. She wants to win the festival talent competition, but she wants to win it on her own merits, not because she's queen. So she enlists Rogers to be her tango partner, but then Rogers gets his heart cracked open because Zelda seduced him into letting her steal Rothbart's notes on the forbidden arts and then dipped in the middle of the night.
Yeah, she fucks.
So he is far too mopey to tango, and Huberta is maybe a little jealous deep down, but mostly she just wants to dance, and this is fabulous. It actually made me and my adult self laugh out loud in the way it's supposed to, like because it's funny and not because it's ridiculous, multiple times. This is also the only time post-original that Brian Nissen finds something interesting to do with Jean Bob. He's given up on actually physically transforming via kiss and instead focuses on winning the obstacle course at the festival because the winner gets to be prince for a day, and then all his friends will see him as a prince. It's really fun. It's a great application for the slapstick inherent to a literal frog, and it's actually really sweet to see him win. Even the music in this movie is a dramatic improvement over the last. It's still kind of lackluster. Our boy Lex appears to have had exactly one hit in him.
Far longer than forever.
But the songs here are way better simply by virtue of having more to do with the plot. The up-tempo animal number builds on the no fear idea in a way that's actually relevant and necessary to what's happening.
So be true to the feelings that you're fighting, cause there's no fear when you're on the right side.
Zelda's number is solid because she's Zelda and she fucks.
There ain't nothing but bad days ahead.
And Roger's doo-wop sadness is a genuine bop.
For the light and love of my life was Zelda, and now she's gone.
Pathetic,
Rogers. Oh, and Derek gets the wistful ballad this time about how his marriage is a mess.
Isn't it enough that I fight the dragons, that I fight the villains and I win the prize? Why must I also get down on my knees? Apologize.
So clearly what happened here is that someone looked at Secret of the Castle and was like, hey, why are Derek and Odette fighting about Derek working too hard when there's an atomic level magic bomb in their basement and Derek said he destroyed it, but actually he didn't? That's way more interesting. And it is! And once again, it goes nowhere! Derek is just so obviously wrong.
I really think that someday we can use their power for good.
And he continues to be wrong.
I did this for us, for the kingdom.
And he gets terrible advice.
That's what we husbands do. We hunt, we fish, we watch sporting events, and we apologize.
So no matter how much introspection he does, he's still super wrong.
After the festival, I promise. Trust me. Nothing will happen.
And Odette almost dies for it again. We get to see some real first movie Odette here, though. Oh, right. Zelda turned her into a swan because she almost walked off with Rothbart's notes, and a swan is easier to subdue than a human. And I love this moment where you can see the gears turning as she kind of tests her surroundings and figures out a plan, and she ends up masterminding her own escape. Drink that shit in, because it is the last time we will ever see a full movie of this Odette again. And Derek falls for the disguised villain trick again.
You keep falling for that fake Odette trick, don't you, big guy?
And Odette fucking dies, but she gets to come back, I guess, because Derek shut the barn door after the horses were long gone and learned fucking nothing.
Oh, I pray something good can still come from destroying these notes.
But then Rogers and Huberta tango, and it's great. Low-key, I think it's kind of fun to revisit something that you liked as a kid and discover that it's actually halfway decent. Like, I remember this being probably my favorite of the three, and I think it holds up pretty well. 9-year-old me had great taste. Suck it! Part 4, Christmas. Okay, so you may have seen this clip floating around the internet. And if you're like me, you probably assumed more context would, if not alleviate the depths of this uncanny valley, my god, at least make it make more sense.
Baby pandas!
No!
And like me, you would be wrong! This happens because Rothbart's ghost wants to destroy Christmas. What? So Rothbart is back as a ghost because he got Derek, who killed him, to open a magic box in the basement and he wants to get his body back, but he can't do it at Christmas because his magic isn't very strong at Christmas because there's too much Christmas spirit and Christmas spirit is stronger than his magic. So he's gonna destroy Christmas so no one will have Christmas spirit and he can get his body back, but he can't do anything at all to Derek or Odette because they've got the most Christmas spirit, so he just keeps casting spells on everybody else to make them mean. Huberta and Rogers are in full swing of prepping acts for this Christmas festival situation, but then Rothbart throws some fairy dust at them and they get all competitive and they're shouting at each other about how their act is gonna be the cutest one, and then they're whacking each other with short sword lightsabers because Rothbart's magic took their Christmas spirit. The existence of lightsabers is to be taken at face value. Lightsabers need no explanation, you fucking ghoul. And while we're talking about these Christmas Eve acts, look at these carolers. Look at them. What do you think their voices sound like? Just like, take a wild guess. No wrong answers here. I'm just gonna take a big sip of this beer, and then we'll listen to them sing. What? Odette is also prepping an act because this is an in-betweenquel and it's her first Christmas married to Derek, and she's stressing about how to prove herself to her in-laws, so she hires a choir of orphans to sing the most I taught an AI to keep Christ in Christmas word salad that you ever did hear.
Christmas is the reason for the season. When Jesus Christ was born.
This song exists in this universe. Everyone knows and likes it. What does it mean? By now you might be starting to get a feel for this movie's ethos on Christmas, which is both very preachy and equally unwilling to define what specifically it is preaching. Christmas is about kindness and music and a really big tree, and it is extremely important that you get on board with that. Is Christmas about Jesus? About as much as a CVS in December is about Jesus. Maybe slightly more, but only because he's a lyric and Christmas is about singing. To be clear, I don't care if Christmas is about Jesus for anyone specifically. I'm just saying this to point it out, plant a seed, put a pin in it. This movie also introduces two new elements that are gonna keep coming up in these reboot era sequels. One, they are weirdly horny in very weird ways.
Someone need poker practice.
Well, maybe Bridget and Big Naughty work together again.
Why am I more confident that Rothbart is fucking Bridget than I was that he was fucking Zelda? I feel like I need a shower. Two, number 9. Because that's the number of lives cats have, see?
I've only got one life left, and trouble always seems to come my way!
This cat is like a ball of everything that is bad about kids' entertainment. This cat is what cynical grown-ups think kids need to make things funny.
Hello, life!
Ah!
Signing on! Signing on!
God, I hate this fucking cat. The best part of this movie is the ending, which is like full The Force Awakens. Rothbart kidnaps Odette and turns her into a swan because we haven't done that yet, and Derek goes to fight him and Rothbart turns into the great animal. Another Death Star! But this time Rothbart is more powerful and it doesn't look like it's gonna go so great, so Odette sings a song! This actually does have precedent. It's been established that music weakens Rothbart's powers because Christmas spirit, so this is reasonably smart, and she sounds like this.
They're sharing a memory of kids. Caring and tender rejoicing.
What? And it works! Rothbart explodes and so does his magic box and Odette is human again but Derek is dead! So Odette sings some more and the ornaments from the Christmas tree! Oh my god, what the fuck? This is great. 12 out of 10. Truly, what a hot mess. I love it. Part 5, A Royal Family Tale. Alright, you ready for this? The Forbidden Arts is no longer a skill set or a physical thing. It's a sentient spirit that uses he-him pronouns. There was a prophecy carved into a rock about how a good and pure swan princess would bring about an era of peace, and evil could not survive in her presence except with a magic glowing stone. So the Forbidden Arts altered the rock to say that an evil
evil swan, an evil swan princess. An evil swan princess will usher in an age of despair and lay waste to the earth and its creatures. When I am feeling sad, I watch the prologue of this movie. Nobody can be uncheered with an evil swan princess. I mean, should we just leave it there? I think we should just leave it there. No, there's too much other crap that's gonna be important later. Fine.
Okay, these are the Scullions. They're a colony of flying squirrels who have formed their society around the doctored prophecy of the evil swan princess.
No further questions, Your Honor.
One of them is super evil because the forbidden arts got to him, and one of them is super not evil and lives on the fringes because he believes in the original undoctored prophecy. His name is Scully because Odette can't be bothered to learn his real name, so she calls him after his species.
I am your loyal servant. What's on golly golly gum, what's on my bang?
I'll call you Scully, if you don't mind.
I do. You're very charming, Majesty.
Great.
He's good at, like, making potions and stuff. This is also a good time to mention that the animation is starting to look significantly less horrifying. Like, one of the great things about the Flying Squirrel Cult Society is that the technology and the team have caught up with how to make animals look good, at least. So the more time we spend with them and the less we spend with people, the better. There's also this issue where the new character models look way better than the ones that have been around for a while. Like, poor Odette is just never going to stop looking like she's about to eat you when she laughs, and also her waist is, like, horrifyingly small for some reason. But her daughter looks, you know, pretty much like a person.
Right, yeah, Odette and Derek adopt a daughter.
Huberta wants a grandchild.
Show me the baby!
And Odette and Derek also want kids.
I want her to have grandchildren, too.
Why are these movies so horny? But they never have to actually explain the birds and the bees because the Forbidden Arts sets a house on fire when Derek and Odette are driving by.
That's strange.
And there's a father and a daughter inside, and the father fucking dies.
Actual death. Human being dies in this one. He doesn't come back. This is rated PG, bitch. You're playing with the big boys now.
So boom, they're in charge of this kid now.
Immaculate Conception!
Her name is Elise, and she doesn't want to talk, but Odette can kind of feel her pain because she remembers when her dad died, which is also when this movie remembers...
Oh shit, we're supposed to be making a musical!
There are like 3.75 songs in this movie, and three of them happen all in a row, 25 minutes in...
Oh, oh, tell me what you're thinking!
She never sleeps, only roams in darkness.
One look from her and you'll burn with fire!
I am here to hold you, I won't let you go.
And then that's it. The quota's been met. We don't need to worry about it anymore. Okay, great. Back to the plot. If you've ever seen a spy movie, you know that Odette is vulnerable now because she loves another human and the bad guys can use that to get to her. The Scullions capture Elise while she's playing hide and seek, so Derek and Odette gotta go save her. The good news is that we get some classic sassy, resourceful Odette who's like kinda irritated that Derek doesn't think she can handle herself and is six steps ahead of Scully.
Gets dicey up there, but give me your hand and I'll help.
Hurry, Scully, come on!
No strength like a mother's love.
Well, if only you knew, bud. She also gets a new outfit with these 2003-ass gaucho pants, so that's fun.
The bad news is that Odette never turns into a swan again. So not only has this amazing pattern been broken, it's been broken in the movie about the evil swan princess. What the fuck do the Scullions think a swan princess is?
Anyway, everything works out. Doesn't matter how. Scully dies, but he gets to stick around as a ghost. Rogers and Huberta get engaged. Elise finally talks. Odette and Derek formally adopt her. And Rogers and Huberta have one minor tiff and call it off.
Will they? Won't they? The world will never know.
Part 6. Princess Tomorrow. Pirate Today! Exclamation mark. This one gets weird. This movie is an abyss of tone. This movie killed the dinosaurs. Spoiler alert, fuck this movie. So any franchise that runs long enough is gonna get a sidekick installment, and apparently 6 movies was long enough for the Swan Princess. So this is our Lion King 1.5, our Bartok the Magnificent, our Penguins of Madagascar, if you will. Odette and Derek fuck off to do hands-on public infrastructure maintenance, good for them, and Elise is left for Rogers and Huberta to have a tug of war over for the summer. Huberta wants to give her princess lessons, Rogers wants to teach her to sail, Elise obviously would rather get on a boat because...
I don't want to be a princess, princess! I want to be a modern princess!
princess.
Hark, a feminism! But Huberta rules with an iron fist, so Rogers and the sympathetic animal friends need to do a whole rescue mission. And now Elise is on a boat, motherfucker, don't you ever forget! She's wild, she's a pirate, just like Huberta was worried about. And they promptly shipwreck on the island full of carnivorous lizard things that we saw in the first scene, devoid of context. And whatever rails we had up to this point, we are off them. So on the one hand, we have Rogers, Jean-Bob, and the Boggs. The lizard things are called Boggs. They want to eat Rogers, but Rogers has the brilliant idea to convince them that they can't just eat him raw when they have such abundant herbs and spices growing all over their island. So he divides them into two teams who have to compete in a full-on reality show to be allowed to cook him. Like, the style of the movie totally pivots. We are on the Food Network now, title buttons and confessional-style interviews and all. Also, the Boggs worship Jean-Bob as a god. Okay. This is the kind of bizarre fuckery I think I'm here for. Except, Elise is also in this movie. In the process of being chased by the Boggs, Elise is rescued by that mysterious kid from the opening scene who we eventually learn is named Lucas. Lucas, it turns out, is from the same kingdom as Elise and ran off to this island when he overheard his parents agreeing to abandon him at an orphanage.
Okay.
Lucas and Elise spend the rest of the movie arguing about whether or not Lucas should give his parents another chance, with Elise taking the side that they're his parents and they must love him because her parents love her, and Lucas taking the side that they were going to kick him out of the house and put him up for adoption. Ultimately, Lucas is forced to leave the island because he swoops in to save Elise when all seems lost, which is a huge sacrifice for him because it means that the Boggs see him, and now that they know he's on the island, they won't rest until they can eat him. So he begrudgingly gets on the boat with Elise, who is dead set on bringing him back to a family he has every reason to believe does not want him. So as soon as they dock in the kingdom, Lucas books it. Elise goes running after him, and meanwhile, Ghost Scully makes sure that Odette and Derek run into Lucas's parents, who are out looking for Lucas because it turns out they weren't going to give him up because they didn't want him. It was because
his father has a disability and can't find work, and they can't afford to feed him.
So, obviously, the point of Scully making them run into the prince and princess, who are so hands-on in charge of the kingdom that they just personally repaired a bridge, is so that they can inspire a total overhaul of disability coverage and employment policy. Or, I mean, it's a kids' movie. So they can wrangle an offer for their family to come live in the giant palace and eat food from a private chef and stuff.
Nope.
The only reason Odette and Derek are here is so they can make sure Lucas's parents are in the exact right place so that Lucas can run into them and they can have a tearful reunion because being separated has made them all realize that they don't need to eat as long as they have their love for one another. And Odette, Derek, and Elise just stand by and watch this. Like, yes, this is the work of angels.
We must have had help from angels, dear.
The help of angels, indeed.
Angels. So we don't need to do jack shit. Fuck this movie. Part 7, Royally Undercover. This is a fun one. I actually really enjoyed it. Specifically, the things about it that are utterly ridiculous are primarily par for the course for a halfway decent kids movie that truly is only concerned with kids, and where they're not, they're interesting. I'm not gonna get too deep into the plot because it's a little on the convoluted side and we've already been here all day, but basically this guy, Count Antonio, is hanging out at Swan Lake and Huberta is smitten with him.
This room is just for my tan shoes.
How dare you cover those lovely feet?
Go to horny jail! So Rogers wants to prove that he sucks for the totally selfish purpose of he's jealous, so he recruits Elise, the animal friends, and Lucas, whose parents have now settled into owning a tulip farm, and they're doing well enough that they can comfortably donate an entire day's sales, so you don't need to worry about them anymore, except that Lucas doesn't like coming over to the palace because it makes him feel inadequate.
Huh, I wonder why.
To be secret agents and find out dirt on Antonio, and and it turns out that he actually is a super bad dude who has it out for Swan Lake, and so they take him down. So rapid fire, here are four things that I loved about this movie. Number one, Antonio's sneaky villain getup is the shit. I'm gonna cosplay it, I'm gonna live in that cosplay, this is the energy I'm bringing into my 30s. Hell yeah. Number two, this sequence where Elise has just overheard Antonio saying that he doesn't really love Huberta, he's just a chronic flirt, you know that.
You know me, I'm a flirt.
And she reports back to Rogers, and the two of them have an amazing scene where Elise, a literal child, does not understand how adult relationships work because she's a literal child.
If Antonio doesn't love her, why does he compliment her all the time and hold her hand?
And instead of giving her any sense that things are sometimes more complicated than, do you want to hold my hand? Yes, okay, let's get married. Rogers gets on exactly her level and accepts her child logic as watertight proof that Antonio is acting suspiciously.
Indeed.
It's great, I fucking love it. This is the best scene in all of the sequels, probably. Number three, there are like three actually really good jokes in this movie.
There might be a time when we need something that looks like a rock.
Okay.
Who knew there were little hallways for frogs above the hallways for people?
It's called a ventilation system.
What's it for? Spying, of course.
Now, we just gotta hope Rogers has some reason to look up at the sky.
Why? Why?
Yeah, those are good, right? I'm not just losing my mind. Number four, there are three songs in this movie. Two of them aren't important. One is a big diegetic group number about how charity good, and one is a non-diegetic pop song about the power of being yourself, which is only a theme in this movie because Lucas the tulip farmer, whose parents almost had to disown him because they couldn't afford to feed him, doesn't feel comfortable hanging out in a palace, but after he becomes a spy and helps bring down the bad guy, Odette calls him a prince, so it's fine. Nobody cares about those two songs. They can go rot. The only song that matters is this one that Odette sings about being worried for her daughter's safety and understanding how her father must have felt. Very heartwarming and sweet and all that, and the second iteration of the song comes in like this.
Sick him!
Are you near?
Holy shit, I love it! But there's something much bigger and deeper we need to talk about with this movie. Those of you playing along at home might have noticed that there's a bit of a VeggieTales vibe that's been slowly creeping in since the series got rebooted. Which, like, that's not necessarily a bad thing. VeggieTales slaps! Nothing but respect for my president. VeggieTales does slap, right? I haven't revisited that much of it with a critical adult eye. Comment below if you want me to do a close reading of VeggieTales. Oh no, don't do that. My brand is already an abyss. I don't think it could stand the addition of VeggieTales. But this isn't the good kind of VeggieTales vibe. This is not a why is there a piano on my cake situation.
Why is there a piano on my cake?
Remember the Island of Perpetual Tickling? Richard Rich could never. No, this is not like teaching London to love with light bulbs. This is like whatever the hell an Easter Carol was.
Christmas is the reason for the season
when Jesus Christ was born.
Long before the age of kings and queens, an evil force, the Forbidden Arts, came to Earth from the underworld.
Yes. The help of angels, indeed.
But like, up until now, this has been kind of very quietly under the surface. Very, very plausibly deniable, you know? All art is on some level influenced by the values of the artists. Not even dog whistles, like bat whistles at best. But this is the movie where we drop all the way into full-on preaching.
Do what you can and just believe.
But more importantly, this. I'm gonna go to my grave thinking about this fucking scene. Yeah, that one. No, that's it. Okay, I'm gonna have to actually explain this, aren't I? I should sober up. So I don't talk about this a lot in my work, but I'm actually a Christian. I was raised in the church and I'm still involved with it. It's a pretty important part of my life. Let me just say up front, I'm not here to evangelize. This is an incredibly specific and personal thing. I've found the right faith tradition and spiritual practices for me, and I wish every single person the joy of feeling secure in the right faith tradition and/or spiritual practices and/or lack thereof for them. But in a past life, I made rent working in the field of youth and children's ministry and formation, aka, reductively, Sunday school. And I'll eat my hat. Forgot a hat. Shit. I scripted that, but then I actually forgot to bring a hat to set. I'll eat a metaphysical hat if this moment in this movie is not an explicit reference to a story known as the Widow's Mite. This comes from the Gospel. The Gospels are the books of the Bible that specifically recount the story of Jesus' life. There are four of them, and they're all a little or a lot different from one another because they were written by different people at different times with different specific purposes. The Widow's Mite shows up in Luke and Mark, and their accounts are blessedly similar, both in the literal specifics and in the greater context, so we're gonna go arbitrarily with Mark in the New Revised Standard Version.
Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on."
Okay, so this is the kind of story that if you're a Sunday school teacher and this comes up in the lectionary, you breathe a giant sigh of relief. Lectionary. My denomination is lectionary-based, which means there are specific Bible readings denoted for specific days. My church uses a 3-year cycle that's been the same since time immemorial. Not every denomination rolls this way. There are a lot of pros and cons. Like, when you're a Sunday school teacher, sometimes, relatively frequently, actually, you have no choice but to figure out how to teach a bunch of second graders a lesson on a super wonky, one-paragraph, 2,000-year-old policy debate. Or an exorcism. Or the Book of Job. And, like I say, pros and cons. This is stuff that is part of the foundational text of my religion, and yeah, I think it's super good and important to start addressing how complicated it is relatively early, rather than pretend it's all sunshine and rainbows until, holy shit, wow, those kids are adults, and the foundation on which they've built a good chunk of their values and social life is way more fucked than anyone ever let them in on. Good luck with that, Timmy. You're not my problem anymore. Doing this stuff well, I would argue, is not only a crucial piece of doing religion ethically, but also, on the teaching side of things, a really meaningful and enriching way to confront the complexities of your own faith as an adult. But it's also exhausting. And I was getting paid a decent wage for that shit. A lot of people in this boat are volunteers. So when you get pitched a softball like the Widow's Mite, you milk the shit out of it. There are characters who do things that you can talk to kids about without getting fired. Glory hallelujah. So I feel pretty confident saying that most people who have ever spent any time ever in Sunday school are gonna look at this scene and have the same reaction that I did. Aha. Yes. Like in the Bible. But okay, who cares?
Oh my God, doesn't this remind you of Jesus?
Well, I care. This is my religion getting thrown around, and I remember what it was like being this IP's target demographic and internalizing the messages it sent me. I made a whole ass video deconstructing it. So, it matters to me a whole lot what this movie is using my literal Bible to say. The astute among you who are watching this video with your eyeballs and not just listening to it will have noticed that when I read you the story of the Widow's Mite, I had to put the name Jesus in brackets as the subject of the sentence. In the Gospel of Mark in the NRSV, that's just the pronoun he, because this is a continuation of other stuff that Jesus has already been up to. So, what has Jesus been up to? Context is a little bit of an abyss here, and you should absolutely be suspicious of me, because the Bible is an incredibly complex text that has a history of being used in ways that say more about the people doing the reading than about the text itself, and I am certainly not devoid of my own biases and aims. So if you're at all interested in this as anything more than my weird tangent, I do highly recommend going to the source directly, in more than one translation if possible, and probably talking to a lot of other people who have lived with this text for a while, and maybe reading some stuff written by a variety of people with MDivs rather than taking my word for it. But if I try to get too deep into it, we'll be here all week. So in summary, Jesus is hanging out at the temple in Jerusalem, and all the heads of the establishment are pissed at him because yesterday he rolled up out of nowhere and literally flipped a bunch of tables and called the church out for extorting its congregants by claiming that buying shit from them was the path to true holiness. And the people, on the whole, thought that said table flipping was a pretty compelling turn of events. So when Jesus dares show his face again, the chief priests, etc., start asking him a bunch of questions that are supposed to expose him as an unqualified hypocrite so that the people will go back to buying extortionately priced holy shit in peace. But Jesus sees exactly what is going on here and handily engages exactly enough to return those accusations of hypocrisy to sender. And in full Streisand effect fashion, a crowd is gathering and they're pretty interested in what this Jesus guy has to say. And this is when Jesus explicitly lets the establishment have it.
As he taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes, and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses, and for the sake of appearances, say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation."
And that's when he points out the widow giving all she has. And the very next passage after that finds Jesus prophesying that before long, not one stone of this great temple will be left on stone. This isn't just some sweet nothing about how nice it is when poor people do a charity. This is about how rich people, swanning around like their money makes them holy, are doing it all wrong. Personally, if I were given this passage as a lay preacher, I'd go so far as to say that the widow is not an aspirational figure, but a tragic one. She is being exploited by a system that tells her the only way to be holy is to give everything she has to people who already have too much. The church has built itself on physical signs of wealth and glory, and the widow shows us that it's done so on the backs of those who have barely anything to give in the first place. Jesus has come not to affirm the church, but to tear it apart and build something new. Now, I don't think that's the only worthwhile way to interpret this story. I don't really believe that there is one single objectively true way to read the Bible, much less that I know what it is. And that's maybe a lot to get into with the youngest kids. I probably wouldn't go quite that grim if I were writing a Sunday school lesson. But I do maintain that any reading of this story that doesn't at least acknowledge that the widow's charity is held up in direct contrast to the scribe's wealthy, performative version of holiness is doing the text a great disservice. So, how does it read in the context of the Swan Princess royally undercover? What a sentence. Jeez. A dam in the nearby kingdom of Trumbo has sprung a disastrous leak, and the kingdom has been pretty well leveled, so the monarchy of Swan Lake has agreed to raise money to help them rebuild. Queen Huberta and Count Antonio, who are currently basically flirting by being aggressively committed to heartwarming charitable works, watch an elderly woman give everything she has to the cause in the form of one single gold coin atop the pile. Antonio's like, "Hey, is that a good idea? Doesn't she need that money? She's a poor."
"Surely this woman needs her money more than those we are helping."
And Huberta's like, "Well, yes, but if I don't take her money, she won't get to feel
feel the joy of contributing to a charitable cause.
I could never deny anyone the privilege of giving.
Huberta, who not 15 minutes ago gave a rousing speech on the inherent beauty of charity from the balcony of her giant palace that is still standing. Huberta, who has an entire room just for her tan shoes. Huberta, the queen of a kingdom where a family having to give up a child they love because they can't afford to feed him is a sad but normal occurrence to be solved by warm fuzzy feelings and Anjali ex machina, will take your fucking money because the act of giving is sacred. If this elderly woman is the biblical widow, Huberta is the scribes, the chief priests, and the elders, and two chapters from now, she will be plotting to kill Jesus. I know it may seem like I'm being dramatic, but this genuinely makes me so angry that I was crying writing about it. The reason why I don't tend to talk too much about my religion, in this part of my life anyway, is that while my church has been such a force for good in my life, and while I wouldn't still be a part of it if I didn't honestly believe it was also doing significant good in my community, and while I know from experience that this is true of many Christian churches and many individual lives and communities, the Christian establishment in my country has done so much material harm on levels from personal psychological trauma all the way up to national policy making that if invoking the same God in whose name all of that bullshit has been wrought turns anybody off, they are objectively correct. And I know that a kid's cartoon about how generosity and charity are nice and make you feel good seems like a strange place to direct that anger, but this is how it starts. Youth and children's ministry is such a fraught and honestly underappreciated field because kids listen. I still remember when I was maybe 9 years old and my Sunday school teacher had a chat with us about the story about Jesus walking on water, and she asked us, you know, that story's kind of out there. A lot of stories in the Bible are kind of out there. Do you ever feel like it's hard to believe them? And a lot of the class agreed that they sometimes did. And our teacher said that was okay. That she didn't always believe everything in the Bible either. That having doubts was okay. That it didn't make you less of a good person or less of a Christian. That it could be a good thing, even, because our church believed that your own personal sense of reason and thoughts and beliefs and opinions and doubts and curiosity were just as much a part of faith as what the priest said on Sunday and even the Bible itself. I still remember that. I didn't think too much about it at the time, but from where I stand now, I honestly don't know if I'd still be a Christian today if I hadn't been gifted that framework at such an early age. It made my religious experience what it was. So, when you take a story about how wealth is inherently unholy and the institutions that exploit their most vulnerable members for the gain of the most powerful will fall, and you twist it into some prosperity gospel bullshit about how the wealthiest members of society have a moral obligation to accept the generosity of those who are struggling the most, more or less without question and without offer of reciprocal aid, because not to do so would be to deprive them of warm, fuzzy feelings, kids will listen. They may not understand, not yet, but they will listen. And I, for one, would like to know who had the nerve to tell them so. Part 7.2, who's responsible? Okay, all right, let's go. I got my first hint at this back when my original Swan Princess video went comparatively viral out of nowhere over a year after I posted it, and I actually went and dug into the black hole of my analytics to figure out why. And it turned out that I was getting a lot of recommended traffic from this The Swan Princess live action concept trailer that, you know, pretty par for the course for this sort of fan-made stuff. But the channel that posted this video is literally just called The Swan Princess, and it's made up of apparently official uploads of scenes from the movies and trailers and also some vloggy stuff coming right out of the animation studio. This is apparently the official Swan Princess channel on YouTube. So let's check out their website. okay, so, I mean, we've woken up in 2005, but otherwise, this is pretty legit, right? I'm still a little suspicious that this isn't just, like, officially licensed fan creations or whatever, so let's see if we can figure out who this is. Okay, Swan Princess Partners LLC. I mean, I'll be honest, that sounds fake, but sure, let's keep digging. Utah. Huh. There's nothing wrong with Utah. I mean, it's definitely not the first place you'd expect to find an animation studio, but you can make animation wherever. It's fine. But it does ring quite the bell for something I came across when I was putting that first Swan Princess video together.
Directed by former Disney animator Richard Rich of The Black Cauldron and the animated Book of Mormon fame.
Aha! Utah. So, who the fuck is making these movies? From their own website, Jared Brown and Seldon Young founded Nest Entertainment in the late 1980s to produce animated Bible films primarily for the Christian market. Primarily. Okay. With Richard Rich as director and Lex de Azevedo composing music, around 70 short animated films, including the Hero Classics, were created. Sony joined forces with Nest and Rich Animation Studios to produce the fully animated feature film, The Swan Princess. The theatrical release of this classic tale was November 18th, 1994. Okay, so this is interesting right off the bat, because one, Seldon Young doesn't start amassing producer credits until the mid-90s post-Swan Princess, if IMDb is to be believed anyway, and two, those animated Bible films were not produced under the name Nest Entertainment. Between 1987 and 2005, Swan Princess director Richard Rich, screenwriter Brian Nissen, songwriter Lex de Azevedo, and producer Jared F. Brown, and eventually Seldon Young, released animated stories from the Bible, animated stories from the New Testament, and animated Hero Classics, a similarly styled series focusing on a bizarre mishmash of historical figures, initially under the name Family Entertainment Network. These days, those titles are available under the company's new name, Nest, with little to no public acknowledgement of the name Family Entertainment Network anywhere that I could find. In fact, I could only confirm that was ever the name of the company from an article from the Mormonism Research Ministry, a fundamentalist organization built on the idea that Mormons are not true Christians and need to be brought back home to the one true church for the sake of their souls. So that's a whole other can of worms. But they were very concerned that a highly popular series of animated short films based on Bible stories distributed by a company called the Family Entertainment Network were secretly smuggling Mormonism into good Christian households. Among their evidence cited is the confirmed Mormon faith of executive producer Jared F. Brown, director Richard Rich, songwriter Lex de Azevedo, and screenwriter Orson fucking Scott Card. Yep, Ender's Game Orson Scott Card, virulent homophobia Orson Scott Card, Obama will put a thin veneer of training and military structure on urban gangs and send them out to channel their violence against Obama's enemies, Orson Scott Card, who, it turns out, was also a screenwriter for the animated Book of Mormon. So was Brian Nissen, and Jared F. Brown was also a producer, and this wasn't just a thing that Richard Rich worked on, it was his first post-Disney directorial outing with his own self-named animation studio. But as excited as the whole Nest team constantly seems to be to bring up that they cut their teeth on good Christian fun, they never seem to want to talk about the animated Book of Mormon. You can't even buy it from Nest Learning, the branch of Nest Entertainment where you can get all that sweet Swan Princess merch and stuff those same stockings with explicitly Christian movies, books, homeschool curricula, and anointing oil. You can buy a bunch of materials that appear to be much closer to the work of the Mormonism Research Ministry and the Sister Wives books. All right, well, it doesn't look like you can buy much of anything right now. Basically, everything is sold out. So I guess I'll have to hold off on fireproofing my marriage with Kirk Cameron and be content with the Love Dare flipbook calendar. The only reference I could find from any of the team was a piece from Salt Lake City Weekly reprinted on the Swan Princess series website where Richard Rich slips up and instead of using that oft-repeated phrase, animated Bible films, calls them living scriptures. Okay, bingo! Living Scriptures is the first company founded by Jared F. Brown and Seldon O. Young in 1974, starting out with audio drama cassette tapes and eventually graduating to film with the animated Book of Mormon. These days, Living Scriptures is a streaming service branding itself as Latter-day Netflix, which its CEO, Matt Brown, openly pitches as a fun way for kids to convert their friends.
I love the story of conversions, where people, the child saw it at some other child's house, and then the parents are like, what is this? And the next thing you know, they're teaching the discussions.
All right, stepping back for a second. I don't want to act like Mormons is synonymous with obviously this shit sucks. Like with Christianity, it is the case that some fuckery has been done in my country in the name of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints on levels from the personal to the political. But, you know, I don't really know all that much about the church, if I'm honest. Definitely not enough to cast aspersions when I've got logs in my own eyes to attend to. Anecdotally, I've casually known a few Mormons in my life, and for what it's worth, my interactions with them would seem to suggest that Mitt Romney and Orson Scott Card are far from representative of the multitudes contained within the faith. But I'm not actually here to talk about Mormonism specifically. What I'm here to talk about is this, like, concentric dog whistling that's happening here. The Family Entertainment Network makes Christian stuff. Living Scriptures makes Mormon stuff. It's always masquerading as something just slightly less specific than it is. You've always got to Google it to figure out what it's really trying to do. And it's hard not to read that as an active attempt to take people who are peacefully chilling at one layer of the onion, who are like, ah, terrific, a thing that aligns with my values, and yoink their unsuspecting asses further toward the fundamentalist center. It is some sneaky ass shit.
You're being sneaky again, John Bob.
What's sneaky?
What's more, if Wikipedia is to be believed, which, to be clear, it's not. The entry on Nest has exactly two citations, and both of them are just backing up that a company called Swan Princess Partners Utah LLC, DBA Swan Princess Partners, owns the copyrights on the Swan Princess characters, because I'm not the only one who thinks that sounds fake. For what it's worth, I was generally able to confirm the other relevant stuff I found there, but not this. So, you know, wildly speculative. But if that page is to be believed, the Family Entertainment Network took on the name Nest Entertainment in the fall of 1994. The fall of 1994. When The Swan Princess was released in theaters. And, you know, whatever. Even assuming that is accurate, there still could be whatever number of reasons for it. Nest is objectively a better name for a production company. It's cute. It's cozy. It gets at the same idea with more subtlety and less ambiguity. And the idea that Christian values are American values was coming up against significantly less scrutiny in 1994 than it is now, if memory serves. So, who knows? But in light of all the rest of this, it's hard not to see that name change as a deliberate strategy to make sure not to alienate anyone who might not be on board with their kids being secretly evangelized by a fucking princess movie. And you know, fuck, all I can say is thank God the Swan Princess movies aren't, on the whole, quite that sneaky. They are still virtue signaling to fundamentalist Christian and Mormon parents that these are safe movies to have in their homes, and they're preaching prosperity gospel garbage to children too young to know any better, but at least they're doing it very, very clumsily. That's some sort of harm reduction, right? I don't know. I need a drink.
Part 8, a royal misery. Mystery. Yeah, we're really gonna keep doing this. It's out of my hands. The swans have my ovaries in a vice. So the last four movies in this franchise, as it currently stands, are basically duologies, where you've got the Elise and Lucas movie and then the Odette and Derek movie. The kids are in this one, but they don't have a lot to do, and this is the most of the grown-ups we've gotten since the evil swan princess fought the literal devil. And this installment is kind of, in a lot of ways, it feels like it's trying to bring 90s Odette and Derek into the reboot era, finally. And so we get a lot of those old patterns coming back. The villain is highly implied to be Antonio, sort of returned from the maybe dead, but that turns out to be a red herring, and it's actually his assistant Niccolo, who's been pretending to be crazy the whole time to throw them off his track. And not only is Niccolo a jilted former associate who's salty that he was always the brains of the operation and Antonio took all the credit, very Rothbart ex Clavius slash Zelda, he's also single-mindedly obsessed with taking his revenge on Derek specifically, despite the fact that Derek did, like, nothing in the last movie. Elise and Lucas did, like, 90% of the foiling, and there's even a whole joke where Derek is trying to swoop in to the fighty-fighty rescue like he always does, and Huberto's like, no, this one's personal, and Derek's all impressed.
Revenge!
Mother? Wow.
But Niccolo has decided that Derek's the one who deserves the brunt of the revenge, and everyone else will just have to be tortured by being sad that Derek's dead.
The others will die a little each day,
for having lost their beloved Prince Derek.
Sure. And Derek and Odette's marriage is, like, better, I guess, but it's still just unbearably heterosexual.
Tell me, is this one of those times when it's okay for a husband to not tell the truth?
Actually, it's required.
The straights are not okay. Also worth mentioning, the music in this movie is both the best in any of the sequels and the most nonsense. The first song is Niccolo singing a duet with himself because he's crazy and he has two personalities, but it is a decent musical theater number in a way we haven't heard in a while.
If I were you, I would listen to me!
So cool, but it's garbage because he sings this alone. This is just how he is, but we learn like 20 minutes later that this is not how he is. He's been putting the split personality thing on as an act so he doesn't look suspicious. So what the fuck? And then Odette sings a song giving Number 9 a pep talk, and his 8 previous lives all come back as ghosts to sing along, and this is honestly the best song in the entire reboot era.
It's time to stand on all fours and man up. Be the cat that you are and man up.
I think Roger's song about Zelda in the third movie just edges it if you're factoring in the original sequels, but otherwise there's no competition. This is great. It almost makes me not hate this fucking cat, but what the fuck? I'm not gonna explain what exactly is happening at this moment because it's convoluted as anything and we'll be here all month, and even if you do understand all of that, it's still not really clear what's going on. And I'm tired. But basically, Odette is hyping this cat up so he can do, something with the rats. And the song ends with him being like, yeah, I'm gonna do it, and then deciding not to do it because the song ended.
Now that there's no music, I'm not really feeling it.
And so Odette has to step up and do whatever it is herself, and so she tries to shoo the rats, but then she gets scared, and Number 9 does finally jump in and scare them off, but then they have to be like, oh shit, let's run after them, because the whole point of this team-up is that they're supposed to be spying on the rats. It's a character cul-de-sac and a plot garbage. And speaking of garbage, everyone else in this movie is tied up with what's going on with Scully! One of the Bogs is also a ghost now, and because he's a ghost, he's a cop, and he wants to bring Scully to justice for stealing the humans from Bog Island 2 movies ago. This plot has absolutely nothing to do with anything except that we get to have a distinctly inferior reality TV conceit, and everyone except Odette and Derek is tied up in it. Ugh, what trash. What rubbish and what awful. Part 9, Kingdom of Music. This movie has the single best premise for a Swan Princess sequel up with which any human could, can, ever has, or ever will come. So in neighboring kingdom, the Empire of Cathay, because it's China, see, so it... put a pin in it. Princess Mei Li is in love with a poor artist named Chen who's under a spell, heavily implied to have been cast at the behest of her father, who doesn't think a poor artist is an appropriate husband for a princess. So Chen's a dragon now, except for like 5 unspecified minutes out of every day. Okay, cool. Yes, tell me more. Mei Li has heard stories about a swan princess in a neighboring kingdom who found her way out of something similar, and so she decides that she and Chen need to go find this swan princess and ask for her help. Fezzik! You did something right! The phrase swan princess, which people have been tossing all over the place with not a swan in sight.
Every year she chooses a Christmas theme, and this year it's a swan princess Christmas.
Finally means something in universe. Odette is a living legend, and now she's gonna spend this movie helping a new friend find her way out of the same pickle. Yes! Goddamn! Sign me the fuck up! This also leads to this sequence.
You died because Derek fell in love with a different woman.
No, I didn't fall in love with another woman. I just made a vow of everlasting love to another woman. Little help here?
I bring this up not because it's particularly good or anything. Honestly, this series was way overdue for Audie's Disney self-aware self-dunks, but because there is a non-zero chance that I was the cartoon overthinker to whom this moment was responding.
This movie was released on August 6th, 2019, just under 1 year after I made my video largely talking about what a dip Derek is for very similar reasons. That's some pretty tight timing in the world of animation, and my channel was teeny tiny at that point. But the reason that video eventually blew up like it did was that at the time, there weren't many videos on YouTube talking about the Swan Princess at all. So it's not outside the realm of possibility, especially if anyone had Google Alerts enabled, and I don't have anything more to say about it other than it's pretty damn surreal. But anyway, this is basically all we get of this storyline's potential. Odette and Derek strike out almost immediately and put Ghost Scully on the case because this is not the A-plot! That is the Swan Princess love triangle! Much more interesting and important, Elise is turning 18 and so we're having a big ball for her birthday, and Lucas is back in town and there are sparks flying.
Wow, you've grown up.
You too.
But then there's also Prince Lee, Mei Li's brother, who's visiting, and he's super uppity, and Elise is all carefree, and she totally offends him, both accidentally and by purposefully calling him like she sees him. But oh look, now they're playing the harp together! Ah, enemies to lovers! Who's she gonna pick? This arc is fun enough. I don't know, it's kind of nice to take a break from any big, major, scary antagonist and just get down into the interpersonal drama. It also gets big points from me for actually being the resolution of the Mei Li Chen situation. The whole thing was that the spell would be broken when the Emperor's child gave up their love, and everyone assumed that meant Mei Li giving up Chen. But then Li sees that Elise is really in love with Lucas, so he sacrifices his spot on her dance card to make sure they have a super romantic moment to realize and confess their feelings. Li gave up his love, he's the Emperor's child, so the spell is broken. It's cute. I don't know. I like it. I'm also a big fan of princess movies where we actually get to see princesses doing politics, and I like seeing the difference between Kid Odette from the first movie, who was really good at her job but also liked to screw around and knew exactly where the line was and what she could get away with, and Elise, who just truly does not give a single fuck. And if anyone had bothered to keep track of Odette as a character instead of just turning her into resourceful Barbie, there could be some really cool mother-daughter stuff in there. Like, she could be like, I know you like playing pirates, but you can't just insult our guests like that. You're a princess now, and you could literally start a war if you don't figure out how to work as hard as you play, but ha! We do get some fun stuff with Rogers mentoring Lucas, but the closest Elise really gets to maternal chit-chat comes from Huberta, because Odette is busy with the C and B plots. Yeah, that's right. There's another story going on here that this movie has deemed more important than the intergenerational mentoring of a parkour ninja princess and her dragon boyfriend. Swan Lake is hosting racist Eurovision. What is that font? That's why Lee is here. He's competing in this music festival that Odette has apparently been hosting every year for this entire franchise.
Not too long ago, when the darkness of Rothbart's spell was lifted, we vowed that every year we would celebrate love and light.
Sure. Inviting delegates from kingdoms around the world to compete, and the winner gets to sing at a big ball. So, our contestants are... Oh god, I don't want to talk about this. I'm the wrong person to talk about this, but we gotta talk about this. Okay. Our contestants are... Humbalani from Azania, whose song is like a Pitbull reject with a Julie Taymor's Lion King shadow puppet intro and backup dancers dressed like this.
Stomp your feet and pound the streets.
Anya from Kievan Rus, who figure skates while singing some very, very Eurovision-y symphonic electro metal about winter weather that literally references Moscow.
From Moscow to Majlika, we all unite in song.
Isabella from San Salamanca, who sings like Despacito, but it's about a waterfall.
La Casca, whoa, whoa, like La Casca.
And Samar from Indus, whose song looks like someone watched a Bollywood number from the second season of So You Think You Can Dance and read one Tumblr post about how the color run comes from a really meaningful tradition in India, actually.
Put your hands together, clap and show me what you got. Let the rhythm move you, show your colors to the sky.
This movie was released in 2019. But look, Jean Bob's being Simon Cowell. He thinks he's on reality TV. Ha. Ha.
The single piece of faint praise with which I will damn this storyline is that they do go out of their way to make both of the Asian pastiche men look dreamy. Lee is one point on Elise's love triangle, and Samar has a horde of swooning fangirls, so honestly, that just demonstrates that there was some level of awareness going on here that makes the rest of this garbage even more gross. 1 star. 1/2 of 1 star. 1% of 1 star.
Part 10, A Royal Wedding.
Ugh, this one sucks.
It takes place pretty much entirely in the Empire of Cathay, so I'm sure the amount of the aesthetic that seems to be directly based on Disney's Mulan is reflective of a lot of careful research and cultural sensitivity, right?
But like, that's not all that. Okay, so like, the plot of this one is that Mei Li and Chen are getting married. I don't know.
It actually starts out really sweet. They get Derek and Odette's help talking to the Emperor, and he turns out to want to be a better father and support his daughter in chasing her bliss, so he blesses the marriage, and it's nice, it's nice.
But then, okay, so the spell. It turns out the reason Lady Jafar, I'm sorry, her name is Fang.
Chica chica fang fang!
The reason Fang cast that spell in the first place wasn't that the Emperor had concerns about his daughter marrying a poor, it was that Fang is in love with Chen. She doesn't want Mei Li to marry Chen because she wants to marry Chen.
What? Okay, sure.
Fang's magic is just- Fang is just- It's a mess! She has the kind of powers where you're constantly like, wait, she can do that? Why didn't she just do that before? Why did she turn Mei Li into an old woman who can try to explain the situation when she always could just make her unable to speak? She can trap people in paintings? Why the fuck didn't she just do that?
This is why the Forbidden Arts was such a big deal for the first 5 friggin' movies, because it's a really easy way to build in a twist in the third act that raises the stakes. Our baddie is powerful, but not that powerful, and as long as we keep the MacGuffin away from them, there'll still be a level of powerful that we can probably handle. But oh no! They got the MacGuffin, and now we don't know if we can still beat them!
Fang doesn't gain any new powers as the movie goes along. Arguably, she gets to use them with less and less abandon as more people find out she's evil, but mostly she just holds off for no reason other than there'd be no movie if she did that. Now, the whole thing just backs itself so far into a corner that the only way it can get itself out is with rules that favor the good guys this time, but also haven't been disclosed until now. There are just new rules flying at everything all of the time because fuck you.
A wizard did it.
It's not fun. Okay, what else? Our poor parkour ninja princess has literally nothing to do for this entire movie, so yeah, that tracks. There's once again just frustratingly wasted potential because Chen spends, like, the whole movie not being able to tell that the person he thinks is Mei Li is actually Fang in disguise, and, like, dude was roasting Derek for that shit 1 movie ago.
The woman I made the vow to was a haggard old woman, but I couldn't tell the difference between her and Odette.
That's a good plot line! Like, let Odette figure out what's happening and commiserate with her. Make this a big thematic thing! For the love of all that is holy, please! This is good! But no, things don't go places in this franchise. Even Huberta and Rogers are no fun. They're undercover! That should be awesome! But Huberta just wants to sing, and Rogers is just trying to make sure that she doesn't, for some reason. Who knows why? She's fucking fabulous when she does. Oh, that's a nice thing. This movie only has the 1 song, and it's actually pretty good. Oh no, there's another one! Fuck, I blocked it out!
Hero, not a bear.
I mean, the Swan Princess wiki tells me this is actually in Mandarin, and Derek not being able to speak the language is very clearly the butt of the joke, so that's...
Sure, that's like 2 things, at least. Finally, for reasons that are entirely inscrutable, there is a sequence in the middle of this movie where the world just turns into a pinball machine. I wanna love it. It's ridiculous, and I wanna love it. I probably would have loved it 5 movies ago, but what was left of my soul departed my body sometime around Humbalani from Azania.
Part 11, conclusion. The Swan Princess franchise, as it exists in 2021, is an abyss. It is a conundrum. It is a black hole from whence no traveler returns. It is an incredibly pushy email list that haunts my dreams. That's not a metaphor. It is literally an incredibly pushy email list, and I don't think I'll ever be allowed to unsubscribe from it. It has no discernible trajectory. It simply is and will continue to be. It is a force of nature. It is a fact of the universe. This is the Swan Princess's world. We are merely permitted to live in it. Once you see the signs, it's impossible to go back. You're awake now. You're welcome. You know what I didn't do in this video? Tier list the Swan Princess movies. Do you want to see me do that? Cool, me too. Do you know where you can see it? Nebula. Nebula is a creator-owned streaming service where cool folks like Princess Weeks, Sarah Zed, Maggie Mayfish, and me can make cool stuff, get paid fairly, and worry way less about some of the unpleasant pressures of YouTube, like toxic comment sections, aggressive copyright claims, demonetization, or creating to please a mysterious algorithm. This is genuinely a really cool thing I'm honored to be a part of, and you should totally sign up for it if you like stuff like No Ads or Sponsor Reads, bonus content from your favorite creators, and entire new exclusive shows. If you're not already set up with Nebula, the best way to get it is through our bundle with CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream is a subscription-based streaming service with thousands of documentary and nonfiction titles, and if you made it through this video, you absolutely deserve to watch The Science of Cute, which is all about very good dogs and the science of why they are so good. When you sign up for CuriosityStream by going to curiositystream.com/LaraCrone or using my link in the description, you'll get 26% off your annual membership for a total of $14.79 with Nebula included for as long as you stay subscribed. That is cheaper than one reboot-era Swan Princess sequel DVD and way more worthwhile. Thank you so much to my patrons for making weird nonsense like this possible. There's actually a series of vlogs that I recorded after my first watch of all of these movies that is available only for my patrons. So if you would like to watch this descent into madness in real time, and also, of course, support the work that I do, you can head over to patreon.com/LaraCrone. And you might even get to see your name up here with these super cool people, like Andreas Evans, Danny, Exceedingly Lizzie, Ilona Consetta, LL Milktray, Michelle, Richard Lawson, Ronnie Rocket, and Sean Payne.
The legend of an evil swan princess? Come on!